Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our holiday live stream. And we've got an incredible program for you this morning, lots of variety, a couple of great solo pieces by Luciano Berio and Philip Glass, wonderful, one of the Paris Quartets of Telemann. And we're starting this morning with a set of four lullabies. But before I get into those, I would like to thank Bill Cates and the Cates team at RBC Wealth Management for sponsoring this live stream. They've been wonderful sponsors for so many years, and we so appreciate their continued support of us. We will start with four lullabies. The first two are French. The first composer, Germain Taillefer, is one of Les Six composers, a wonderful 20th century composer. And then we're going to be performing Ravel's Versailles, on the name Gabriel Fauré, in which he takes the letters of the name Gabriel Fauré and he assigns a note to each letter of the name and creates a beautiful melody out of it. The next two lullabies are Russian, first from the composer Lyra Auerbach, and she wrote a set of 24 preludes for violin and piano. This one is marked Adagio Sognando, which means dreamy adagio. And then finally, we will end this set with Schnittke's rendition of Stille Nacht. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I would like to introduce our spoken word today, Dr. Lee Francis IV.
Guazi and good morning on this wonderful December morning. I am so thrilled to be back at Chatter. It has been a number of years, and it's only taken a pandemic to get here. So I am blessed and so excited to be able to do a little bit of poetry and regale with stories as the best we can, and wish all the blessings to everybody in this space. So I begin with my first poem called The Dreamtime. When we open our eyes from the nightmare, and I hold your hand, tan and wrinkled, older than I remember, but so am I. Red rocks mark our passing, and the eagles dance for us when we dream again. And it's raining on Blue Mountain. That was a poem I wrote for my father many, many years ago, and I find it to be very relevant now of how we are moving out of this dreaming time as we move through the winter and hopefully into a much brighter spring, where all of this beautiful energy that has been sustained by these amazing events through this time, even digitally, are going to be the things that carry us forward, that are going to allow us to wake from a slumber with these beautiful dreams that we can all enact and carry out. So the next poem is a winter poem. This is entitled Winter Calling. Winter is on the phone. Winter is in a parking lot in South Jersey, dialing the number for memory, calling you back. Winter is on the phone, telling you about the traffic, telling you about the weather, telling you about her day. Winter is too far away for you to understand what she is talking about. Winter is on the phone, trying to get through, trying to reach you before you head out for the evening. Winter is on hold, listening to White Christmas on a hammered dulcimer. Winter is spiraling out of control, sliding on the ice, and you can barely hear her through the static. Winter is on the phone. Winter is crying for attention, begging for clarifications, yearning for warmer weather in the Southwest, like the trip you took 2 years ago and came back smelling like sunsets and dandelion. Winter has never seen a dandelion, and winter has never seen a sunset over the mesa. Winter only has a stack of postcards with the word wish written across the back 100 times. Winter is on the phone, complaining about how her clothes are too tight, how her clothes bite at the edges of her frame. Winter is scratching her throat, coughing a secret message in frosted windows and swirls of fingerprints left on your summer fine skin. Winter is smooth and beautiful, lying in repose at the end of your bed, tangled in the sheets. Winter has skin of bone china, and sometimes winter is so clear, you can see her heart blossom between the cracks in her ribs. Winter is slow to speak. Winter is staring at the wall. Winter is staring at a picture of a postcard pressed into the adobe background of a bitter sunset. Winter is restless. Winter is dreaming. Winter is frozen in a nightmare of stubborn whispers pulling at the top of her scalp with frozen branches brittle beneath her weight. Winter is melancholy in the morning. Winter is angry in the evening. Winter is on the phone, trying desperately to explain the sudden drop in pressure at the tips of her fingers, trying desperately to explain the sudden drop in temperature, trying desperately to remember how she got home and why her knuckles were bloody and why she was missing her jacket and her shoe and why she feels betrayed by the sunset and the nameless stars that left her alone, staring at broken floorboards, long hallways, maps and weather systems printed in dandelions on the backs of picture postcards. Winter is there on the phone, listening to a dial tone, waiting for you to pick up the phone. So my next poem is a bit brighter than that poem, but as we work through these winters, I feel that there are always these memories that come back, and that's part of what that poem before was all about. But this poem in particular brings it as we look forward to spring. And this is for my amazing poet wife, who has been here recently, Liza Jean Wolfe, who was here, Wolfe-Francis, who was here just a couple weeks ago at Chatter. And this was for her. This was one of the early poems that I wrote for her. So this is a love poem to my incredible poet wife and all of her amazing talent. The poem is called Once We Met. If we met, for instance, in a diner, and we kissed across the table, and we conned the night into staying longer, and we nodded over peaches and cream like a full moon drifting somewhere over Georgia, and we sang songs the jukebox had forgotten, and we giggled about Jesus in tennis shoes, and we collected ourselves like pigeon feathers and squares of colored paper stuffed in rusty lunchboxes, and we agreed that time was an empty shell left on the beach by a child who could only hear the rushing of his breath when he placed his lips against the cheek like Judas marking him for exaltation shortly before the dawn. If we did all that, would we sing sunrise hymns to each other, to the sky, and to unknown children still finding shells on the beach? Or would we write letters to the ocean using only blue crayons and asking for the secrets to buried happiness, unending love, and amazing seafood recipes? If we met, for instance, at a train station, and we begged for poems from passersby, and we drank wine from a shared brown paper bottle, and we stared into the flashing cross lights, hoping to remember how our names were spelled in Morse code, and we gave each other wooden nickels in exchange for promise rings, and we listened to old men praying to a god who had long ago given away everything he had, and now simply hums to himself quietly in a small house in upstate New York while he tends to the gladiolas in his living room. If we did all that, would we still send postcards with no return address of the places we visited in our dreams? Or would we still believe that ghosts and angels live around the corner in a two-bedroom condominium that slightly resembles a Victorian townhouse we almost bought years ago in Baltimore City? If we met, for instance, at the end of our lives, and we wished the evening would deal like Faust, and we felt disappointed for only the second time in a generation that gravity was quite simply the most abominable thing we could think of, and we smiled at the thought of resting our feet on the edge of a porch and finagling old friends into one more cup of coffee. If we met then, would we give each other notes in the margins of dog-eared novels and careworn crosswords? And would we spend our days fishing the Mississippi in a little town that has one hardware store and one diner, and was once the hometown of a man who now tends gladiolas in upstate New York? So for my last poem, I might have done this the last time I was here, but it has been many years, so I'm not entirely sure, but this is a pantuum. And a pantuum basically is like a 1-2, it's a repetition poem where all the lines interlock with each other over various times. And I know there have been numerous poets here on this amazing stage, and I am so glad myself to, again, be able to be back. I want to thank Sunday Chatter, to all the staff, to all the incredible musicians who have kept our spirits alive during this trying times. There's nothing that I could wish more than the arts to everyone. So this is an older poem, but I think it is very fitting as we look forward to a bright and wonderful 2021. So thank you all for allowing me to share this stage and this space, and we'll see you on the flip side. So this is called Making It Last, a mustard seed pantuum. There are gardens everywhere we look, and they are green and they are golden. We must be careful to let them tangle and twist in the sunshine, unafraid to step into unknown stories that wrap around each leaf and stem, and unafraid of hard times, always unfinished, always reaching to the sky. We must be careful to let them twist and tangle in the sunshine, these mustard seeds. They will grow tall and joyous from strong soil and unafraid of hard times. Always unfinished and always reaching to the sky, they will blossom and grow in ways we are not even able to imagine. These mustard seeds, they will grow tall and joyous. From strong soil, they emerge with prayers on their leaves, which we will eat and form stories. They will blossom and grow in ways we are not even able to imagine from months ago when we first pressed our hands into the earth. They emerge with prayers on their leaves, which we will eat and form stories. These ancient plant dreams remind us that we are also mustard seeds from months ago when we first pressed our hands into the earth and began this journey of growing. And now we understand. These ancient plant dreams remind us that we are also mustard seeds, unafraid to step into the unknown stories that wrap around each leaf and stem and begin a journey of growing. And now we understand. There are gardens everywhere we look, and they are green, and they are golden. Dawae. Thanks.
Sequenza by Luciano Berio is actually the first of 14 that he wrote for orchestral instruments in expanding the range of the specific instruments. So this is Sequenza 1, written in 1958. The two large solo flute works that he based this off of was Syrinx, and Varese Density 21. With this work, he devised his own system of rhythmic notation. So it's really like a proximal relationship for notes. And there's an intense collaboration then that results between the composer and the performer. This is a colossus in the 20th century flute repertoire, and I'm super excited to be playing this.
Thank you. Philip Glass wrote his 8 songs and poems for unaccompanied cello back in 2007, relatively recent work for the cellist Wendy Sutter. There's a very clear influence of the Bach cello suites in these pieces, particularly in the way the material he uses and the way he exploits the sonority of the cello. They're really fine works, and I'm happy to be playing the 2nd of these songs and poems for you.
Thank you.
Thank you.